building. It's severely constrained by the very small size of the plot on which the development is proposed. Effectively, the design seeks to accommodate a 4-foot plot. As the proposal fails to make any provision for the on-site damaging of vehicles, the resultant provision of 2 on-site service car parking spaces fails to provide any on-site visitors car parking spaces. This is most likely to result in vehicles parking on the adjacent right-of-way, which will create a further hazard and potential danger to horse riders, hikers and so forth. It is also noted for planning application question 10, the applicant advises that the existing number of existing car parking spaces on the developed site is nil. Respectfully, this is not the case. The existing tarmac service hard standing area immediately adjacent to the south of our end is very readily able to accommodate 4 or 5 vehicles. The proposal would materially reduce off bridle path visitor car parking and remove the existing facility for loading and unloading delivery vans, which is existing in the patronage of this expanded far end. No intention. The suggestion increases the surface area, proposed development of landscaping, and the result reduces the soft landscaping amenity, as shown illustrated in the attached drawings. In the planning application, may further reduce natural soakaway of standing surface water. I picked this one because in Far Hall Drive, this is the bottom of Far Hall Drive, so it's on the bottom end of the hill, and it readily has most years flooding to the extent that it's very difficult to get through with the car. So building another bungalow on the bottom of this end would reduce that soakaway and would exacerbate that problem as well. So that's why I picked that one. For all the reasons I've pointed out, I would respectfully request the committee on the grounds that to reduce the planning application 180/00621, contravening HS2 and Overbill and HS4 Street C. Thank you very much, Chair, for your time.
Thank you. In the planning history, we've been close to the application process by Councillor Rowland, so that's the officers to come back on some of those points through the content information.
Sorry, through you, Chair. I'm not sure that they're entirely relevant anyway, because they relate to the on the screen, it's the existing runway to the north of the application site. That's actually included. There was an application that was approved in 2017 for the remodeling of that property. But we're not looking at that. What we're looking at is the erection of the new road in the edge, the side edge, correct? So that's why it's not listed.
Okay, can I move up to Commissioner Fields, Kathy, through you, Chair, in a nutshell. And basically, I want to view the site. It is very tiny. I simply said I'm going to have a garage which a garage on it. I can see that the 300 house, I think, is stretching it a little bit. The current proposals, it is in the report, but the current proposals attempted to address concerns which are two of the things that they haven't. Am I right in when he says attempted? Just the clarity.
Well, no, that's not right, because if we felt they hadn't addressed the previous areas for concern, then we wouldn't have brought an application, a recommendation to you for approval. So it has gone some way to address the previous concerns.
I can just hang on and just say that the fact remains that the application site is a small part of the garden of an existing house, which itself is one of the smaller gardens in Far Hall Drive. The building would still approach very close to Far Hall Drive, closer than its neighbours to either side or to the general setback of houses in the area. It would also be dominated by the existing house. It's therefore not of a scale which relates well to surrounding property. It's closest to the highway, compared to its neighbours, means it's not a similar form. But it doesn't provide the HS41 and also result in detrimental change to the character of the area, contrary to HS42. I do have a point of refusal later on, Mr. Chairman.
Okay, is anybody else like to speak on this? I would just like to remind this committee that we have been on site visits and we've seen sites which are very small and which we've refused in the past. And they have been overturned as a few. If you recall that application. So I think, you know, we may feel that it's a small area, but when this has actually come to appeal, we have had the officers refused, it will only be sort of refusal. So just to add that as a caution, really, to members. So did anybody else want to speak, or we go to that Cathy Moon refusal? Okay, Cathy, come on.
I'd like to move refusal of proposed dwelling to represent an unacceptable subdivision of the existing plot, resulting in a rampant overdevelopment of the site, harmful to the character and appearance of the area, thereby contrary to policy HS4 of the adopted rule of industry and development plan.
Thank you, Cathy. Do we have a second in this? Thank you, David. All those in favour of the refusal? Members against refusal? Okay, so that is lost. Sorry, that is carried. It's unanimous, that is not approved. Thank you. Okay, committee, we're actually now going to move to agenda item 5, which is pages 23 to 26.
Thank you, Chair. This application is with two-storey and single-storey extensions, including raising the ridge height of the roof by approximately 1 metre. The existing property is a two-storey detached dwelling located on Mill Main Victoria Avenue. The dwellings along Victoria Avenue are set on spacious plots and have a mix of designs and external finishes. The minor increase in the ridge height will have limited impact on the appearance of the dwelling or the character of the area. There will be high over secondary window at first floor level on both side elevations, together with stairwell windows on the northeast side elevation. Conditions being attached for these to be obstructed by 8 mm to prevent any overlocking into neighbouring properties. The main two-storey cottage dwelling is set on by the side boundary at sufficient distance to ensure it does not harm the amenities and neighbours. Given the small scale of the single-storey extension, it will not have an adverse impact on the amenities and neighbouring properties. Overall, the alterations to the property should enhance the appearance of the property and will not detract from the character of the area or the amenities of the neighbours. The application is therefore recommended for approval subject to the conditions.
Okay, can I, we don't have a walk out, please, we're going to do. Okay, can I close to the committee, please?
Chair, can I just
approve a second? Okay, Cathy, did you want a second?
Yes.
Okay, all those in favour of approval subject to the conditions listed? That is true. Thank you. That's carried. If we now move on to agenda item 6, please, which is on pages 27 to 32 in your pack.
Thank you, Chair. The three elements to this application, all of which are retrospective, they are the alteration and extension of the existing building, together with its continued use of the chapel, petrol and storage. The alterations were part of another building with a small room to be used as a hairdresser's and the construction of a new single-storey storage building. The application cites a large compact set within the green belt which contains a number of other established buildings and uses. with a large pet food retail store, equestrian centre and caravan storage. Other sites have been agreed about proposals like a part of community development plan, but there's a presumption against inappropriate development in the Greenbelt. The National Plan of Policy Framework states that construction of new buildings in the Greenbelt should be regarded as inappropriate other than for certain exceptions. Exceptions include a limited inflow of a previously developed site, which would not have a great impact on the openness of the Greenbelt and the purpose of included land within it. The application site is considered to constitute previously developed land within which limited inflow is therefore considered to be acceptable. Overall, to consider that these developments constitute a limited inflow of a previously developed site, especially compared to the significant large existing building structures and uses on the site. It's not considered that they have a greater impact on the openness of the Greenbelt and the purpose of including land within it. In that case, we therefore recommend it for approval. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there a
will
of council to speak on this one? No, I'll
take a
visit
after this.
Just a very quick one. As somebody who used it to place a dog food, gerbil food, goldfish food and parrot food, I wondered whether that needed to declare interest. But I think so many people probably go to Larkinwood that would be ridiculous. We don't have a committee decision. So may I just second what Ron has said. It provides a valuable service for the community. This is a very, very small additional number of buildings which you can find well within the site. And I have no hesitation in supporting what they're trying to do.
So, I've had a move from the seconders, so those in favour of approval subject to the conditions listed. That is unanimous.
Can I ask the new chair, should we not call for the final application of Councillor Ellison for the zoo?
Yes.
Number 7 on Zoom, please. So pages 33 to 38, please.
When you're ready, can you have
a
presentation?
The planning commission is sought for changing the use of this forward bank into a restaurant. The building will be laid out with tables on ground floor and first floor, a small bar area and surrounded seating areas. The kitchen and surgery will be located on the ground floor. The premises are located within the traditional suburban centre to where restaurant and bar uses are directed by both policy SH2 of the UK Development Plan and supplementary planning document 3. There are a mix of uses within the centre, including travel agents, hairdressers and a convenience store amongst others. There are a couple of takeaways further along Burlington Road and the King's Arms public house on the opposite side of King's Lane. However, it is considered that the proposed use of this building as a restaurant will not give rise to unacceptable levels of noise and disturbance. There is a small foyer area which separates the entrance doors from another set of doors within the building that will assist in limiting any noise carried from inside the building. The flats on the opposite side of Old Chester Road, so on that now, just to the one of the sides, are within 40 metres of the front entrance of the building, at a distance of some 31 metres. However, they are located on the opposite side of the busy Old Chester Road and King's Lane Junction, and given the site's location within the traditional suburban centre and the conditions proposed, it is considered that this is an appropriate reuse of the building that is likely to generate significant additional levels of noise and disturbance. As recommended for approval, there is no petition or objection in association with this proposal.
Thank you, Matthew.
Thank you, Matthew.
Thank you.
Second.
Okay, does anybody want to make any contribution, please? So we've got a move in the second. All those in favour, subject to the conditions listed. That's unanimous. Could somebody drive Cathy back in, please, Brian, could you?
Yeah.
We could ask her first. We're
asking her, yeah.
We're asking very nicely.
Okay.
Okay, so we're going to move on to agenda item
Okay, permission is sought for the conversion of this two-story dwelling into three separate units of accommodation. At present, the ground floor consists of a lounge, dining room, kitchen and downstairs bathroom, with three bedrooms and an upstairs kitchen and bathroom on the first floor. It is proposed to house a one-bed flat on the ground floor with kitchen, lounge, diner and bathroom. At first floor, there will be two units of accommodation. At the front, a one-bed flat with kitchen, lounge, diner and bathroom together with a small studio apartment consisting of kitchen, dining and lounge area with a bed and a shower room to the rear of the premises. There is a small area of hard sand to the front, southwest, front of the site, and a small hard landscape garden area to the rear, which could be used for bin storage. Three units of accommodation at good levels of outlook are proposed, and the proposal would not involve any changes to external elevations. The premises are located next to bus stops on both sides of the Croydon Road, allowing for easy access to public transport. Proposals are considered to be acceptable and are recommended for approval by the judicial association.
Okay, we don't have a board council review, so can I get up to the meeting, please? Pat?
Thanks very much, Chair. So I guess a lot of members will be familiar with where this property is. It's opposite the former Cole Street school on Portland Road, and it's already operating as two flats, even though there's no reference to any planning history in the report, and it's already known to the Rural Council due to reports of antisocial behaviour. My concerns about this application are kind of threefold, and two of them relate to the first floor plan. So I'm just wondering, is it possible to get the proposed first floor plans up on the screen? Would that be possible? So the first point really relates to, so we've got on the first floor, we've got these two flats, one bedroom flat, then a studio flat to the rear of the bottom end of the drawing there. So first of all, if you read the report, you see that the private sector housing team has raised concerns about the size of the studio flat, and specifically what the officer there has said is as follows. In relation to the first floor rear studio flat, the combined floor area is approximately 16 metres squared. Having viewed the Housing Act 2004 and the Housing Health and Safety Rating System, I can advise that this flat would be deemed too small to be considered an adequately sized unit of living accommodation. And the officer goes on to quote, he suggested, the closest floor area to that being suggested for a self-contained flat is contained in the Chartered Institute of Environmental Health document. That provides for a bedroom living room of 40 metres squared and a kitchen of 5.5 metres squared. So the total habitable floor area they are recommending is 19.5 metres squared. And that's compared to what we've got here, which is 16 metres squared. Okay, so secondly, you've got the one bedroom flat on the first floor. So if you look at the top left of the drawing there, there's an extremely small bedroom. It's only 5.1 metres squared. So the single bedroom in the one bedroom flat is only 5.1 metres squared. Okay. If you look at the government's technical housing standards, they require that in order to provide one bed space, a single bedroom should have a floor area of at least 7.5 metres squared and is at least 2.15 metres wide. So they're saying 7.5 metres squared, and what we've got here is 5.1. And the width is 1.98 compared to their recommendation of at least 2.15. Now, from the case officer's point of view, the concerns raised by the private sector housing team relate to non-planning related legislation, while the government's technical housing standards can only provide a guideline. As the officer's report says, and I quote, at present, Wirral Borough Council does not, as local planning authority, have adopted policies that regulate the size of rooms within new dwellings. including those formed through conversion. Nonetheless, the applicant's agent has been informed of the concerns raised by the private sector housing team. Now, the way I read that really is the housing officer telling us as councillors to adopt a policy that gives officers the ability to refuse applications like this. Now, we've been here many times with HMO applications, which we have refused for reasons of inadequate bedroom size. Now, I admit that we've had mixed results on those in terms of subsequent appeals, but it's totally unacceptable to me that we have failed to address this issue, and it has to be a priority in terms of the new local plan. I'm very glad that Cabinet Member for Housing is here to look at this application. You know, we don't have policies that give officers the weaponry, if you like, to refuse applications like this. And again, if you read the conclusion to the report, it says the proposed development will provide an acceptable standard of accommodation for future occupants when assessed against adopted planning policies. But I think the officer, the way I read it, is giving us a very clear steer here that our adopted planning policies are not good enough. So the third concern I've got really is the amount of outside amenity space. So three living units, we're going to need six wheelie bins. There's also a condition on cycle storage, which you have sufficient storage of three bicycles. There's no way that the outside amenity space can accommodate properly the imposed conditions. So, Chair, I do have wording for a refusal, which I'm happy to move once we listen to what the members have got to say.
Thank you, Pat. David?
No, I'm just all in agreement.
Can I just respond? Because I think it's important being just to make that for all very members. I don't think anyone should be supporting that thing, but what we need to do is give the officers from planning that guidance and policy that could be put down in statutes. And we aim myself and Stuart have already met with the report for the housing transportation. I don't see there's any difference in that at all, and therefore I believe that at this moment in time, that should be refused, we should put down some legislation.
Any comments from anybody else?
Sorry, could I just ask, we've proposed, we're not allowed to speak, are we?
No, we're not.
Thank you.
Could I ask you to refuse on that, please?
Yes, so I would refuse on the following grounds. The development proposed, having regard to the size of the building, by reason of the number of units proposed, would result in an over-intensive use of the building, resulting in cramped and unsatisfactory living conditions that fall short of the good standard of amenity for occupants of buildings sought by paragraph 17 of the National Planning Policy Framework.
Do we have
a
second
of
that? George? So, all those in favour of refusal? That's unanimous. Thank you. So that application is refused. I think now moving to agenda item 10, please, which is pages 49 to 52 on your hand. Are you ready? Can we have the presentation, please?
Thank you. This application is for the erection of a first floor extension of the side of the property has been referred to committee of the agent as an elected member of the council. The property is a two-storey flat dwelling and a proposed extension will be above the existing garage. Extension will appear subordinate to the main dwelling and will not have a significant impact on neighbouring properties. The addition is attached to ensure a side and rear window are truly on east and rent over morning. The application is therefore considered to be acceptable and the recommended.
Item 11, please, which is pages 53 to 58 in your plans.
the old colonial bridge street. When you're ready, can have a presentation, please.
Prime permission to sort the restoration of the basement area of these premises to be used for license purposes, together with internal alterations and a ground floor extension. The site has previously been used as a public house for a change of use into offices in 2009. This application seeks to return the ground floor of the basement to the previous A4 use as a bar, with the first and second floors remaining as office space. The use will allow for somewhere for people working in surrounding premises or somewhere to relax, but also allow for the business to be more viable and re-establishing a stronger use supporting a diverse range of facilities within the area. The proposal is recommended for approval and there is no petition in connection with this application.
We didn't have
all the
council for this,
so
I'm moving it to committee.
And just a comment about the results. It's the first time I've ever heard the bar has been built in Spain. So I was inside. I don't think that we have a little cost to do that before. Both of them are sorry to find the confusion. It's visible.
The spenders are aware There is a 29 signature petition from residents objecting to this application. I myself am not speaking for or against the application. I'm hoping to highlight a couple of issues which, if addressed, I feel could help make this application more acceptable to the residents. Excuse me. I fully understand that the applicant wishes to maximise the return on their investment and therefore build as many houses that are being practical on this plot. I'm also aware that residents who have lived at this location for a number of years will feel aggrieved with the knowledge that the street scene on the new pair properties will change considerably. Unfortunately, this is normally the case with most planning applications. First point I would like to raise is the close proximity of the property number one, Tamark Road, to the five parking places, which are only 6 metres from this detached bungalow. The front of the bungalow, which consists of a bedroom, a bathroom, a WC, plus front door and hallway. We imagine the impact on the resident with vehicle headlights shining into the property and particularly into the bedroom, not to mention the noise and the fumes. As a compromise, I would like to ask that a substantial brick wall of a minimum height of 2 metres is a requirement of the planning permission if granted. The wall would need to be of sufficient height and length to give maximum protection to the property, headlights, noise and fumes. My second point is to do with traffic. I would like to make you aware of the geographical layout of the area. Road Close is a small residential area on Puckerdale Road, which joins Overchurch Road. This is a main arterial route which links Morton Shopping Centre with Soho Massage. This is a busy route for traffic and pedestrians. Many years ago, this area was typically made up of small properties, mostly two-bed bungalows, on large plots of land. What we see today is a lot of these plots are being redeveloped into 4, 5 or 6 properties. This has an effect on the infrastructure and increases traffic and creates parking problems. This is evidenced in pavement parking, double parking and drivers parking in side roads such as Rome Close and Tamark Road. Residents of Tamark Road are concerned that they already have problems with residents from other roads parking in Tamark Road. I feel that this situation could increase with additional properties in Rome Close. Therefore, the suggestion is that if the request for a brick wall between number one Tamark Road and the parking spaces is adopted, can the brick wall be continued on the late land of Tamark Road, albeit at a slightly reduced height? At present, a wooden fence separates number eight Rome Close and Tamark Road. The concern is that once the new properties are built, a wooden fence, if that's what it was, could be opened up to form a gateway which would give easy access from Rome Close to Tamark Road. This would encourage visitors or residents to Rome Close to park in Tamark Road, whereby a brick wall would not offer this opportunity. And in response to that, and say that when I arrived at the town hall tonight, I had a brief conversation with Matthew Parry Davis, and Matthew advised me that planners were looking at some sort of a environmentally friendly fence, I think he called it, which would possibly address the situation with the headlights and some of the noise and possibly fumes. The preference from residents would be for a brick wall rather than a fence, mainly because a fence would deteriorate over a number of years, whereas a brick wall is more permanent. And I would just raise your attention, call your attention to the drawing that's up on the screen at the moment. And you can see, I think Matthew could point out possibly where the parking spaces are intended to be, compared to the front of the bungalow, which is, as I said, it's only six metres. It's extremely close, and something needs to be there. The residents' preference is a brick wall, because of the concerns that that were raised opposite through the planners. There is concern about the impact that these parking spaces would have on the number one Tamar Road. So I would ask that, as a part of the planning application, that stipulations put in place to ask for the required brick wall. Thank you.
Thanks, Chris. Okay, I'm going to ask one of you to sort of clarify the recommended conditions and reasons in under number two, because he says that covers the fencing aspect of it. So we just ask you to do that, please.
Thank you, through you, Chair. One of the plans listed in condition two, deals with the landscaping screen, this fence is shown on that. The other discussion I had with Councillor Berry was around whether or not the fences would be sufficient enough to protect the community, so particularly the people living in window number six, and we had a discussion about whether or not we could propose an additional condition to require an acoustic type fence rather than a normal garden style fence that will provide a buffer for lawns and also for the headlights that the council referred to in his presentation. Similarly, they would like a strong objection to a wall there either. 2 metres is probably a little high.
Okay,
can I open this up to the committee then, please? Thank you. Yeah, I don't think it's unreasonable from what the councillor said, and the developer building that number of bungalows, they don't have bricks involved, it wouldn't be too difficult to build up water around that stuff to protect the people who are already.
Any other comments?
Just a quick one. George, can you put your back? Sorry. Thank you. Just on the basis of that, I always thought the 1.8 was a maximum because I had to go to without a permission. So I'll be on a couple of things in your own work there. It has to be taken down and tried to.
If it's approved as part of the development, then that's okay. There are obvious development rights that allow for fences to be erected without permission. And depending on where that fence is, you can put it up. So if it's adjacent to a highway, it can only be 1 metre in height. I think more than that will have to be planning permission. But if it's a fence that separates two rear gardens, for example, then you could put a fence up to 2 metres.
Okay,
yeah, just a question, Matthew. Has this not been here? Do we have to move with that as a case? So we feel pretty low to say, stipulated that the more severe law, I would be happy to support the law. I would recommend the height of 1.8. So we have to move that. So it's an emergency position.
Okay, so prior to first occupation, a 1.8 metre high brick wall shall be erected along the boundary between 1 Tamar Grove and 5 parking spaces adjacent. This wall shall be retained thereafter unless otherwise agreed and written by the authority.
Sorry, and along the length of the
property
itself has been built. As the point is being made to prevent access being transgressed into the world.
Okay, that's
there is an existing fence along that boundary. So does provide, that does prevent access from Table Island Road. It's the committee's decision whether or not the rule is more appropriate to the fence.
Well, I think a continuous wall would make sense from the point you've developed. If you're facing it all day, you wouldn't be able to.
I think what I'd like to see is which areas we're talking about, if somebody could point them out, please.
Yeah. So what I suggest is a wall on the day, a modification to how a wall is. But there's a further suggestion that it return the corner and come down here to prevent access from Table Island Road into the kitchen side. But there is one other suggestion.
Okay, and can I just ask as part of the two that you talked about before in terms of the landscaping, can I just ask if that is to remain and it's you know would remain there or are we saying that could be removed? Okay. And I think we could take the point that fence of rot and walls don't quickly. So I think I probably would prefer to see the wall continue. I don't know what the manager's saying.
Can I just potentially put a counter to that? What George had said about the issue that we looked at in October. A long stretch of great wall that we decided was faulty was carried down less in the club. And looking at the length of it, it just strikes me that once it's built, people might not be as happy with it as they might think you did. Whereas a wooden, there used to be trees, etc., but a wooden fence is like protection.
One way of getting over that chair might be to have the design of wall that was a little bit rather than something like the side walls of Alton Jail, something a little bit more sort of imaginative, maybe with sort of features in it or something. Would that be something you would be asking to do or something you could ask them to produce and support under section condition 2 and condition 4?
I think that the concern raised was that it would be easier to blast the hole through a wooden fence than a brick. Well, frankly, it isn't, if you wanted an access there at some point in the future, they just knock the wall down, it's like the access. It's not going to make any difference whether it's, in my view, whether it's a continuous fence or whether it's a brick wall, it's just that concerned. If you think about it, that a wall could very well be able to facilitate this work.
Maybe
it's
through watch for the wall.
Okay, can I just have a further clarification? Do bear with us. So, when we're talking about putting the wall, this area here, what was this here, please? Is that just the highway?
Yes,
okay, so we're talking about the brick wall being facing the highway.
Yes.
Okay, so what did the committee, we've heard from Stuart about it may or may not look excessively nice, but what's the committee's view on this, please?
Does it have to be 1.8 metres going